So it is my great pleasure now to introduce Dr. Frank Longo. I was talking to Frank. The Alzheimer's Association has funded Frank's work, I believe, four different times. I met him back in the late 80s, early 90s, when he was at the San Francisco Veterans Administration Medical Center. He went then from there. Well, let me just get on to his actual CV, and I'll be accurate about this. Dr. Longo is professor and chairman, Department of Neurology and Neurological Sciences at Stanford University. He received his MD in 1981 and PhD in neurosciences in 1983 from the University of California, San Diego. He completed his neurology training at the Department of Neurology at UC San Francisco, where he was recruited as an assistant professor and promoted to professor and vice chair. From 2001 to 2005, he was the chair of the Department of Neurology at the University of North Carolina, Chapel Hill, and since 2006 has served as chair of the Department of Neurology and Neurological Sciences at Stanford. While at Stanford, Dr. Longo has overseen a major expansion in the clinical research and teaching programs in neurology, including in the area of Alzheimer's disease and cognitive health. With support from the Alzheimer's Association, the Alzheimer's Drug Discovery Foundation, and the National Institutes of Health, he and his team pioneered the development of novel approaches for the treatment of Alzheimer's disease and other neurodegenerative disorders. A lead candidate drug for Alzheimer's disease was developed, by Dr. Longo and has successfully completed phase one clinical testing. Dr. Longo is one of the rare neurologists who has created a new therapeutic approach and has attained success in mice and actually advanced to testing in human trials. We have some of the finest Alzheimer's science in the world in Northern California, and we are delighted to have with us today a part of that exciting science in Northern California, Dr. Frank Longo.
Well, thank you, Bill, for that nice introduction, and I want to also thank the committee of the Northern California and Nevada Alzheimer's Association for inviting me. And I also would like to welcome everyone here. I know that this group consists of many professionals in the field of caring for families and patients, and there are also families and people that directly affected by Alzheimer's here. So welcome everybody. The goal for this session is to really update ourselves on strategies for preventing and treating Alzheimer's disease, and trying to separate what's real, what has real evidence, and what's just one of the hundreds of things on the internet that one could find, you know, claiming effectiveness. And my job is to separate those two areas for you. Okay, so to talk about ways of preventing Alzheimer's or slowing its progression, we have to have an up-to-date, accurate view of what's going on in the brain with Alzheimer's disease. I know some of you probably are experts, but just to make sure everybody's on board, I'm going to put everyone to work and we have to make sure we understand what's going on in the brain. So in our brain, we have 100 billion neurons. Those are the blue circles there. Sometimes they're called nerve cells. I call them neurons. And they connect to each other, forming circuits. And so you can see the one on the left is extending what we call an axon, and it's forming a synaptic connection, or a synapse, with a spine on the dendrite of the next neuron. And so the messages, or the circuitry, is traveling from left to right. That synaptic connection is the most delicate parts of our brain. And the part of that synaptic connection that's the most vulnerable in aging, and especially in Alzheimer's, is the spine, that little nub along that dendrite there. The electrical signal goes along that axon from left to right. When it gets to the end, neurotransmitter chemicals jump from the end of the axon onto the spine, and a message goes through. In the lower panels there in green, on the left-hand side is a dendrite with normal spines. Those little nubs coming off there are spines. This is how our dendrites in our brain look when we're young and when we're not affected by Alzheimer's. And on the right, we have an image of those spines withering away in a situation of, as we get older, we lose some of the spines, and with Alzheimer's, those spines are very much affected. So the takeaway from this is that we have these synaptic connections. We lose them a little bit with aging, but they're especially vulnerable in Alzheimer's disease. And any discussion about delaying onset, slowing progression, or treating this disorder has to deal with not losing these synaptic connections. So what goes on in the brain during Alzheimer's disease? We have accumulation of two substances, amyloid and tau, and we'll hear these terms over and over again in any consideration of Alzheimer's disease. Amyloid is a fragment of a normal protein. The job of that normal protein is called APP. It's not really well known. It may have something to do with establishing synaptic connections, but a fragment of that protein called amyloid accumulates in the brain, and this amyloid is toxic to those synaptic connections. It causes them to degenerate. Another protein problem that accumulates in the brain is called tau. Again, tau is a second normal protein in the brain. It has a normal function of keeping those neurons intact. But for some reason in Alzheimer's disease, an abnormal form of it that has an abnormal shape accumulates, starts to accumulate in the brain. And that abnormal form of tau is referred to as tau tangles. It's a bunch of tangles of abnormally folded tau protein. And those tangles accumulate. And they're also toxic to these synaptic connections and the neurons. So we gradually lose the connections, and then we actually start to lose the neurons themselves in later stages. Those two things are accumulating in the brain, and they start very early, even before our patients start to have cognitive difficulties. One hears about these a lot because the current therapeutic efforts are directed towards dealing with these accumulations. This is an image of what they look like. Those brown clusters there are amyloid plaques, and the darker stained neurons there are filled with tau tangles. So we have plaques and tangles. This is what it looks like inside an Alzheimer's brain, and these processes are starting 5, 10, 15, 20 years before the first cognitive symptoms start. So as we think about preventing Alzheimer's or delaying its onset, we can think about the stages that are relevant to many of us. So the first stage is what we call age-related cognitive impairment. Now, who in this room has that? Yeah. If there's anybody here over age 30, you have it. So there might be just one or two people here like that. And so it is true that after our late 20s, our processing speed slows down a little bit. Our short-term memory ability to remember a name or a phone number or an email is not quite as effective, but they're generally pretty good for most of us. And they gradually decline into our 50s and 60s. And then in our 70s, it becomes much more noticeable. But usually most of us start to notice these things in late 40s and 50s. But the good news is certain things, aspects of cognition do improve with aging. Verbal ability keeps going up into your 80s and 90s. The ability to figure out problems based on experience, that keeps getting better and better into 80s and 90s, so-called wisdom. So many of the important things will keep getting better. So stay positive about these things, but the short-term memory and processing speed might slow down a little bit. Anyway, that's age-related impairment. We all have that. Some of us will progress on to what we call a subjective cognitive impairment. These are the patients that come to our memory disorders clinic at Stanford or UCSF or elsewhere, and they're concerned about their memory function. They're noticing it's not quite where it was, and they're worried about it. But when we put them through formal testing, and we do that, we have abbreviated ways of testing cognition that many of you are familiar with, such as the mini mental status exam. And then we have more precise ways that our neuropsychology colleagues do that are 3 and 4 hour test batteries. And we put them through the testing, they come back with normal scores. And their day-to-day activities are intact. If they're working, their job is going well, nobody's expressed any concerns. And so that would meet this criteria of subjective cognitive impairment. We can't find a problem, nobody observes a problem, they're just concerned. Some of them, most of them will remain fine, but for a small proportion, we don't really know how to identify them quite accurately yet, but for a small portion of those people, they might be in the very early stages of Alzheimer's or another neurodegenerative disorder. Now, some will go on to develop mild cognitive impairment, so-called MCI. We read about this in the news quite a bit because for many patients, it is an early stage of Alzheimer's disease. This is where this person who's having memory difficulty or other cognitive difficulty comes to our clinic. We do the testing, and they are in the abnormal range. And we may think of that as two standard deviations below their age-matched peers in the various cognitive areas that we test. So there is a cognitive impairment, but their day-to-day activities are basically intact. There might be some small issues, but they're basically intact. The more complex and challenging things that these individuals might be involved with, if they're still working, for example, in a difficult area, they might start to be affected. But because their day-to-day activities are intact, they don't meet criteria for dementia. We say they have mild cognitive impairment, so-called MCI. For people that are diagnosed with MCI, and that's a formal diagnosis, over the subsequent 5 years, they have roughly a 35-40% chance of converting to Alzheimer's disease over the subsequent 5 years. So it's a serious diagnosis to get, MCI. And then finally, we have people that come in. Their testing does show significant cognitive loss, and their day-to-day activities are impaired. That meets the definition of a dementia. Dementia is a broad term. A common question I get from our families, what's the difference between Alzheimer's disease and a dementia? This is really confusing. Dementia is a broad term meeting that definition of cognitive impairment and affect severe enough to affect day-to-day function, but there are many causes of dementia. Alzheimer's would be the most common, making up about two-thirds of all dementias, but other disorders can cause dementia. Low vitamin B12, low thyroid, a brain tumor, normal pressure hydrocephalus, too much fluid water accumulating in the brain, a series of small strokes throughout the brain, Parkinson's disease eventually develops dementia. So as a neurologist, our job is to sort out which of the dozens of causes of dementia does this patient have, and most of the time we end up concluding that it's Alzheimer's disease being the most common dementia. So that's the difference between dementia and Alzheimer's disease. So what do in our clinic? We take a careful history, all kinds of clues in the history about what kind of dementia this might be. We do a careful physical exam, including a careful neurologic exam. We're looking for clues in terms of what might be causing these cognitive issues. If there's weakness on one side of the body that's new, that's not characteristic of Alzheimer's disease. I mean, be thinking of other causes of the dementia here. We do a careful cognitive exam. Today, in 2015, the imaging we do is primarily an MRI, but I'll show you what's happening in the future as we move forward. And we do some blood tests to not miss some of these other causes of dementia, B12, thyroid, and in certain cases, other tests. And when we do all this, we end up about being 85% accurate or so in making a diagnosis of Alzheimer's disease. So we call it, technically speaking, probable Alzheimer's disease. Now that's kind of frightening that a diagnosis that serious, we're only 85% accurate. One would want 100% accuracy for a diagnosis that's that serious. And many of us at Stanford, UCSF, and across the country are working on better ways of brain imaging, better blood tests, so that we can make these diagnoses more accurate. We know that sometimes we might be wrong, and that's why we continue to follow our patients, and we continue to look for other things to see if we miss something or not. So this is a demonstration of just some of the pencil and paper testing that we do when we assess cognition. We'll ask a patient to draw a clock on a blank piece of paper, put the numbers and the hands in, and make it say 2:45. This patient started with a fairly upper left there, fairly normal looking clock, and you could see over time, this patient developed more and more difficulty knowing where to put the numbers, how to fit the hands in there, until finally, just the whole idea of a clock is difficult to execute. So this demonstrates loss of visual spatial capabilities, which are one of the classic abilities that are affected in Alzheimer's disease. This is an MRI scan, and I think when people are first introduced to MRI scans and dementias, they'll think that we got our MRI scan to look for Alzheimer's disease. And an MRI scan, the best MRI scan in the world, cannot detect Alzheimer's disease. It tells us whether there's a brain tumor there or not, whether a series of strokes may have occurred that we really didn't know about. It can suggest that normal pressure hydrocephalus might be there. So it's really looking for other things. And if the MRI scan is normal, it's telling us those other things aren't there, but it's telling us absolutely nothing in terms of whether this patient does or does not have Alzheimer's disease. It's not detecting tau. It's not detecting amyloid. It's not looking at whether the brain circuits are working correctly. But we get an MRI scan to look for these other entities. So moving forward beyond today's MRI scan, what do we have? We have various kinds of PET scans being developed. PET scanning is a technique where a radioactive tracer that sticks to something is injected in the vein, gets into the brain, sticks to something, and the scanner can detect radioactivity that's in the brain, and it lights up in bright colors on this image here. So on the left-hand side there, on the top is an Alzheimer's patient, on the bottom is a normal, age-matched person. And the MRI scan looks pretty much the same in both the Alzheimer's and normal person. Now, it is true, in Alzheimer's, the brain shrinks slightly, but our brains shrink slightly with age, and just looking at for shrinkage is not a very accurate way of knowing if Alzheimer's is there or not. A new kind of PET scan can detect tau, the abnormal version of tau. This kind of PET scan is still under development by a number of companies and centers across the U.S. It's not available clinically yet. Stanford will be involved in testing one of the tau PET scan approaches, but it's still under research at this point until the methods are developed to be accurate enough. There's also an amyloid PET scan. This detects the amyloid accumulating in the brain in the bright colors. You can see how the Alzheimer's patient has much more amyloid accumulated, but the normal person has a little bit of amyloid accumulated. You can see there on the bottom. The amyloid PET scan was approved by the FDA about 2 years ago. However, Medicare and insurance will not pay for an amyloid PET scan still, because their question is, how does it affect care and treatment? And they argue that if something really doesn't affect treatment or care, we're not paying for it. The retail cost for getting an amyloid PET scan is about $4,000. I think it's come down to about $3,000. We offer it at Stanford. We'll occasionally have patients, families that would like an amyloid PET scan, and they're able to get it at Stanford, at UCSF, if they pay for it themselves. The reason why Medicare doesn't pay for it is because right now, at least, we don't have a drug to clear that amyloid out of the brain. So they say, well, you know, why do you want to order the scan? How will it change anything? People were hoping it would be helpful diagnostically, and the complication there is by age 70, one-third of us will have amyloid accumulated in the brain, and the scan will look like this. So one-third of normal 70-year-olds, if we take 70-year-olds who have no cognitive complaints, a third of them will have a positive amyloid PET scan. So you can see why we hesitate to order it, because it comes back positive. What does it tell us? Where it potentially is very useful is in our 55-year-old who's developing some cognitive symptoms, and we're not sure what's going on there. we do know that this amyloid starts to accumulate in the brain in Alzheimer's patients 20 years before their cognitive symptoms start. So if I have a 55-year-old whose amyloid PET scan looks like this, they're likely to come down with Alzheimer's disease. So that's where the amyloid PET scan, I think, will play a big role. It's in the earlier onset dementia. So for example, the main character in Still Alice, right? She was age 50, coming down with cognitive symptoms. In a normal 50-year-old, unlike the normal 70-year-olds, I'm not expecting to see amyloid accumulate, and if her brain probably looked like that with amyloid accumulation. So, but it's still not paid for, because if you're 50 and your brain looks like this, I don't have a drug to clear the amyloid out. I hope we will at some point, but it's not available yet. Anyway, remains a controversial area. I hope this gets paid for at some point, and efforts are still underway to have Medicare pay for this. Those tau and amyloid PET scans that I showed you show accumulation of something, but they're not telling us if the brain circuitry is functioning normally or if it's affected. That's what we really want to know, because that's the bottom line of how our memory and other cognitive functions work. Mike Gracious at Stanford pioneered a technique, and we're still working on this, of visualizing active circuits in the living human brain. That's been a dream for decades. So what he did was he used in a very advanced way of analyzing MRI scan images. It's called resting state functional MRI. And what he was able to do is have circuits light up, shown in orange there. On the left-hand side is a healthy elderly person. On your right is an early Alzheimer's person in early Alzheimer's disease. Those orange circuits are circuits connecting the hippocampus, the part of the brain that's critical for memory, with the rest of the brain. Notice in the early Alzheimer's, those circuits are degenerating. They're less active. This was a huge breakthrough to see if circuit function is normal or not in an Alzheimer's patient. This technique is not accurate enough yet to use in our clinic on a routine basis. That'll be a goal. But this gives us a glimpse into hopefully the near future of how we'll be looking at brain functioning in a much more accurate way than today's simple MRI scan. So what will we be doing as we move forward? Now, in terms of preventing Alzheimer's or testing for it, if you go to your internist today, there's not that much they can do. We'll talk a little bit about what they can do. But I think what we'll be doing in 5 and 10 years, all of us will have our DNA sequenced, and it'll be on our medical record. So we'll have everybody's profile of what kind of risk genes they have for Alzheimer's disease. We'll get a blood test to look at profiles of different proteins, especially immune system proteins. They'll also gauge our personal risk for Alzheimer's disease. Tony Weiss-Corey at Stanford is a world leader in that kind of testing. And we'll get one of these advanced brain scans that Mike Gracious and his team at Stanford are developing. And we could see how for each individual, we'll have a personal profile of genetics, blood activity profile, brain scans. We might get it at age 45, at age 50. So right now, all of us are advised to get our first colonoscopy at age 50. Well, at age 45 or 50, we will be having our Alzheimer's profile done, hopefully well before we have any symptoms, so that we can come up with strategies to prevent it. And then the prevention strategy will be personalized for each one of us. We're not here yet, but this is the goal that we should all be heading toward. So what are some risk factors for dementia, and what can we do about them? Well, I mentioned genetics. We'll talk about that a little bit more. Lack of physical exercise. We'll talk about this a lot. So-called Western diet, high trans fats, et cetera. Various medical conditions, diabetes, hypertension, those medical conditions accelerate these neurodegenerative processes. Lack of sleep. We'll look at that one some more. And one that's been emerging more recently, are people that have been on the older form of anticholinergic bladder medications, people that have been on them for 10, 15, 20 years. That's been associated with higher rates of dementia. So let's talk about genetics a little bit. To do that, we have to remind ourselves that there are two forms of Alzheimer's, the so-called sporadic or late onset that can occur to any of us coming from any family. This form of Alzheimer's is the most common form, more than 98% of it. Generally, the symptoms start after age 65. Versus the so-called familial Alzheimer's disease, it's less than 2%, and the onset's in the 40s and 50s typically. In this familial form of Alzheimer's, the family carries a gene, presenilin 1 or presenilin 2, or a mutation in what's called the APP gene, and these are inherited as autosomal dominant. So if one parent has it, each of their children are at 50% risk. So in the Still Alice book and movie, she had a presenilin 1 gene, each child's at 50% risk. That's the familial early onset form. Most of us are dealing either in our families or with the patients we work with the late onset sporadic. The big gene, of course, for the late onset sporadic is the APOE gene. It comes in three different types, 2, 3, and 4. And it's that type 4, the so-called E4, that puts us at particularly high risk for coming down with Alzheimer's disease. So to summarize the effect, I've divided it up into, for any of us, if we have no family history, neither parent has Alzheimer's, and they lived a full life, presumably, each of our lifetime risks are about 15% of coming down with Alzheimer's disease. If we don't have the E4 version of the APOE gene, our risk is lowered to 9%. If we do have one or two copies of the E4 gene, we're up to 30%. So it gives you an idea of the risk that having the E4 gene carries if we have no family history. But for those of us with one parent with Alzheimer's disease, the risks are even higher, and that's because there are additional genes conferring Alzheimer's risk in addition to the APOE4 gene. So if one has a parent with Alzheimer's but no E4, one's up to 30% lifetime risk. If you're unlucky enough to have a parent and an E4, the high-risk version of the APOE gene, your risk is up to 45%. And if you're one of the 2% of people that have two copies of E4 and a parent, you're at very high risk, 60% risk that you'll come down with Alzheimer's disease. So you see, our risk is really largely dictated by our genetics, our parents, and whether or not we have the E4 gene. Until 2 years ago, we could find out our APOE4 status with 23andMe. Companies spit in a tube, mail the tube in, and then they look at several hundred versions of genes. The APOE gene is one of them that they offered on their panel, and then the FDA shut down that service because FDA said they hadn't studied the implications of people getting this information enough, and so the FDA shut that down. I don't know if anyone here has tried the 23andMe service. They also gave you your ancestry and things like that. Interesting. It's also possible to go to a physician and they can take a blood test and tell you what form of APOE genes that you have. I generally don't recommend this because I don't want on my medical record the fact that I have the E4 gene, if I have that. I haven't tested myself yet. I was about to do the 23andMe testing and they got shut down. Well, it's technically against federal law to discriminate based on genetics for health insurance. That's the law. What's actually executed by insurance companies, who knows? So I advise my families, I would not want this on my medical record. The nice thing about 23andMe is no one knew that you got that tested. That was not on your medical record, right? So that's one note of caution. In fact, one study was done when people were getting their E4, their APOE results. The ones that got the E4, the bad news, the high-risk gene, they were 5 times more likely to buy long-term disability insurance. And of course, on that insurance application, they did not write the results of this test. they put themselves in a difficult position, because if the insurance company could prove that you knew this, they don't have to make the payout. So it gets very complicated. So I would just advise on, you don't want to do this recreationally and have it on your medical record. Where we use APOE results, again, going back to the 50-year-old that comes to our clinic with early stage of dementia starting, that's atypical for 98% of Alzheimer's situations. And so we're really looking for the other 30 causes of dementia. If we know that patient has an E4, the high-risk APOE gene, that helps us weigh the odds that this might be early onset of Alzheimer's versus something else. So that's where it is medically useful to get that testing. And for that patient, they're already showing signs of dementia. They already have this on their medical record if they are dealing with dementia. So this doesn't put them in jeopardy. This E4 effect was recently discovered by Mike Gracious at Stanford to be much more powerful in women than in men. And now he's delving down into that fact to try to understand the mechanisms of how this E4 contributes to Alzheimer's. And if he can understand why it affects women more than men, that could be a clue in terms of preventative therapeutics for Alzheimer's disease. So we're wishing Mike Gracious luck with those studies. So let's talk about preventative strategies, because we do have them, and let's know everything we can about them. So we'll discuss the ones that we hear a lot about: cognitive exercise, diet or nutraceutical approaches, sleep, and physical exercise. And I spend a lot of my time doing research, but my favorite part of the week is in our memory disorders clinic at Stanford, because that's when my patients and families train me. And they train me about what's out there, because they're asking me continuously, does this work, does that work, does this work? They'll come in with hundreds of things off the internet. And I love it, because for no tuition, I'm getting trained on a constant basis. So since I develop therapeutics, I try to keep up with all of this. And so in the next few minutes, I'm going to bring you all up to date. And I'm going to save you from looking at 10,000 websites right now. I'm going to distill 10,000 websites down into about 7 or 8 slides. OK, here we go. Which one of these is the most effective? If you could only do one, which one would you do? Sleep more? Think so? That's what we hear. Does the evidence support that? We'll find out. Okay. Let's look at brain exercises first. This is a controversial area. One can go on Lumosity or on Posit's website, pay money each month, and train your brain. Now, and there has been a paucity of evidence that this brain training does anything to improve cognition or affect age-related cognition or delay Alzheimer's type of cognition. And so this study was published by Adam Ghazali's group at UCSF 2 years ago in Nature, and it was very prominent because it's probably the first really good study addressing one of the key issues in this field. The big problem with cognitive training is it's been fairly obvious that if you sit in front of a computer and do a certain task over and over and over again, you will get better at it. But the big question has been, well, what's that got to do with real life? Does it affect other areas of cognition? If I get really good at this brain game on a computer, will I be any less likely to lose my car at the mall, or forget to pay a bill, or leave the stove on, or any less likely to develop cognitive issues? No one really knew that. So what they wanted to do is see if this training on this brain game that they designed would spill over or transfer — transfer is the key word here that the neuropsychologists use — transfer to other cognitive domains. Would it have a global or powerful effect on the brain? So they trained a group. These are people with just age-related cognitive function, not Alzheimer's disease. A third of them got trained to keep that car on the road. That's a single task of driving. A third got trained on the middle, the single task of responding to symbols that come up. These symbols were a command: press this button, do this. So you're responding to a symbol. That's a single task. And then The third third had to multitask. This was the hardest one. They had to keep the car on the road and respond to these commands at the same time. So a much more challenging task. So what they did was they practiced this for 1 hour, three times a week, for a month, this brain training exercise. And then they came back 6 months later, and they underwent cognitive testing in other parts of the brain. And they found improvements in working memory and vigilance, two different areas of cognitive functioning, only in the multitasking group, only in the group that had done the hardest set of brain training. So there was some transfer of effect, because doing these tasks did not require working memory. But yet, their working memory got a little bit better. So this is really the first time that transfer effect was seen in a reliable study. But this is done in a laboratory setting, not in a home, normal environment. So my understanding is they are working on a commercial version of this game. This is not commercially available. And we'll see what happens. This is just one study. In medicine, we like to see lots of studies saying the same thing. But that's pretty much it for a good evidence for a transfer effect. And it's just one small study. There has been so much marketed and sold. This has become a big business now, this brain training, that a group got together from many institutions. They happened to be meeting at Stanford. And they weighed in on this controversial area. This is what they said. Scientific evidence does not support the brain game claims, Stanford scholars say. 69 scientists at Stanford University and other institutions issued a statement that the scientific track record does not support the claims that so-called brain games actually help older adults boost their mental powers. We object to the claim that brain games offer consumers a scientifically grounded avenue to reduce or reverse cognitive decline when there's no compelling evidence to date that they do. So that's the conclusion as of late last year. I think that there might be some beneficial effects with the appropriate exercise, and I just think we need more research in this area. So I am open to some kind of effect with cognitive training, but I think we should just all be up to date that we have very little evidence at this point. My own personal hypothesis is that what benefits the brain the most is what I call cognitive engagement. Having a purpose and engaging with the most complex thing in our environment, i.e. a person. And I think there are benefits there, but we just don't have the research showing that yet. And I don't think this does much harm, but you can see we have very little evidence so far. Okay, what about diet and supplements? And I'm actually going through what my patients ask me. What they would love to have a sitting at the computer solution. Most people would think that would be great. And the other very popular solution are supplements. If you could walk into GNC and prevent Alzheimer's, that's the way to go. So any data for that? Thousands of websites for it, but any data for it? I'll review with you the Mediterranean diet literature, but I would encapsulate it by saying indirect evidence that we might be reducing risk by some 15 to 25%, those of us that can have enough willpower to stick to a Mediterranean diet. What about coconut water, coconut oil? I've been asked this more than 100 times, and I scour routinely for data there. There is no reliable data. A friend of mine at the University of South Florida, Dave Morgan's group, is doing a prospective study. No results yet, small study. We'll see if they get any signal of activity there. What about omega-3 fatty acids? That's a big one. And there have been several studies there, ranging in doses up to 1,000 milligrams twice a day. There have been some hints of effects here or there. But really, there's just no overall significant effect in the trials that have been done so far. We'll talk more about that. Vitamin E has been all over the map. There was a New England Journal article in the late 80s that said vitamin E was effective in Alzheimer's. Then other studies couldn't reproduce that. There was a study last year that said there was people on 2,000 units a day of vitamin E had a 19% reduction in the rate of decline of activities of daily living. That made the news. However, when one reads that study, one finds there were no effects on cognition, no benefit effects on cognition, a core problem in Alzheimer's disease. Even worse, there was a study in the Annals of Internal Medicine about a decade ago. The patients on vitamin E supplement had a 10% higher death rates than patients that didn't take vitamin E. And I had one of my patients say, why are you killing me with the vitamin E? There may be no free ride there with the vitamin E. What about vitamin D? That's a big one lately. It affects the immune system, cancer, heart health, everything. There are studies starting to emerge now, epidemiologic studies, suggesting that if one's vitamin D level is pretty low, less than 25, that's a pretty low value, that there might be roughly a twofold risk of getting a dementia. So that's just an epidemiologic study. It's not testing moving forward. So it'd probably be a good idea not to have vitamin D levels. And most of the primary care physicians at this point, most of the internists will get vitamin D levels on people. As we stay out of the sun, our vitamin D levels go down. And then finally, turmeric, curcumin, that's been discussed for a long time. And I've been told over and over again that they get less Alzheimer's in India. So I tried to track down the study or studies that showed that, because I've been cited that so many times. I finally found in some obscure journal somewhere that somebody had done this little epidemiologic study in some small village in India that had that as a conclusion. That's it for a country with 1 billion people. And with all the other factors ignored, people might walk more, get more exercise, be less overweight, the other aspects of the diet are different, it goes on and on, the demographics are different. Anyway, we don't want to miss anything. A group at UCLA that was really passionate about curcumin and Alzheimer mechanisms, had worked for years in it in mice, did a clinical trial and it was completely negative. As far as we know, curcumin doesn't get through the blood-brain barrier very well, although people say when it's cooked in Indian food with the correct oils and stuff, it does. But I would just say right now we have no evidence for it. I love eating it, but we don't have any evidence for it. Okay, back to the omega-3 fatty acids, and here's a cautionary note. You might say, okay, it won't do me any harm. I'll, take some fish oil pills. There have been, I think it's 4 studies so far, that in men, the people that have high omega-3 fatty acid levels, generally from supplementation, have a 40% increased risk of prostate cancer. So you don't necessarily get a free ride with these benign-sounding supplements. And this has come from different groups, different studies, so it might actually even be true. So I think it's just a cautionary note that delaying or preventing Alzheimer's may not be as simple as a nutraceutical. And nothing is necessarily safe in my mind. There are always risk benefits. Here's a cautionary note on omega-3 fatty acid supplementation. So just to summarize Mediterranean diet, because I think if there is some effect there, it's the overall diet rather than trying to take pills. And this is a complicated slide, I'm sorry, but I just wanted in your handout to list the actual studies. These are recent reviews. Here's one in 2014. They looked at 6 longitudinal studies. These are studies where they follow populations over time. And 5 of the 6 showed a lower Alzheimer's risk on people that adhere to a Mediterranean diet. 2 out of the 3 showed reduced conversion from mild cognitive impairment to Alzheimer's of people who are on the Mediterranean diet. There's only been 1 prospective trial where they take a group and put one group on the Mediterranean diet and one not. That only lasted 4 weeks. They had some improved, what they call biomarkers, various measures, and some improved visual memory. A second article in 2013 reviewed 11 what we call observational trials. 1 randomized clinical trial, there have been 2, And they did find some lower rates of cognitive decline and decline in Alzheimer's risk in 9 of the 12 studies. The effects on MCI were not consistent. And finally, in the third one there in 2010, they looked at 7 longitudinal studies where people were followed over time. And people, they have, there's a point system that measures somebody's adherence to a Mediterranean diet. You can be really well adhered or medium adhered or poorly adhered to your Mediterranean diet. But for every 2-point increase in your adherence to a Mediterranean diet, you had 13% less risk of any neurodegenerative disease. And finally, on the bottom there, another study looking at 5 longitudinal studies. People in the top tertile of Mediterranean diet adherence had 20% less chance of getting MCI and 36% less chance of Alzheimer's. So overall, you know, my summary of reading through all of these papers is about a 20%, roughly, ballpark idea risk reduction in people adhering to a Mediterranean diet. This is hard to study. I think all of us need to understand the difference between a retrospective epidemiologic study and a prospective randomized study. Does everybody know the difference between those two? 99% of what we see in the news are association studies where people that say do something or on a Mediterranean diet have less something. There's an association between Mediterranean diet and say less Alzheimer's. Associations can be deceptive and tricky because maybe the people on the Mediterranean diet are doing something else also. Like maybe people on Mediterranean diet exercise more or something. And it's the something else that's lowering the Alzheimer's risk and not the Mediterranean diet. So these epidemiologic or association studies don't tell us about cause and effect, but they're easier to do, and that's what's in the news. A prospective trial is much harder, much more expensive to do. That's where I say take this half of the room, moving forward, for the next 3 years, you stay on a Mediterranean diet. This half of the room, for the next 3 years, you have to go to Burger King and McDonald's 3 times a week, okay? And then everybody come back 3 years from now and let's see how you're doing. And we're going to make sure before this trial starts that the smoking rates, exercise rates, diabetes rates, hypertension rates are equal between the two sides of the room. That's called a prospective trial, difficult, expensive, and in some areas like Mediterranean diet, really hard to do. Can I really convince you to not eat well for the next 3 years? And are you guys going to really stick to this Mediterranean diet for the next 3 years? That's a hard trial to do. And that's why our data is so limited. That's why we're limited to these association trials that we always have to be careful about. What about exercise? We have about 10 more minutes to go. Let's look at an effective exercise here in just normal older people on hippocampal atrophy. So the hippocampus, part of the brain critical for establishing new memories, the part of the brain in most people most vulnerable in Alzheimer's disease and vulnerable to aging. It shrinks gradually as we age. So that yellow part of the brain there is the hippocampus, one on each side. And the volume of the hippocampus in normal people as we age shrinks 1 or 2% per year. That doesn't sound like very much, but it's like an interest-bearing account. You do not want to be losing 2% per year because that adds up, right? So this study was done up in Seattle, and they decided, let's follow people for a year, and we'll measure the size of their hippocampus with an MRI scan. We'll have one group do their normal thing, which they weren't walking or exercising, it's normals. And the other group, we'll have them walk. We'll start at 10 minutes a day and gradually work up to 40 minutes a day. And then we'll measure the size of the hippocampus. So the control group, the non-exercisers, their volume of the hippocampus was that red line. We see this gradual loss of volume in the routine non-exercisers, and that was expected. So they thought the goal was in the walking, people who walked, would they reduce that slope, reduce that rate of shrinkage of the hippocampus? That was the hypothesis. Let's see what happened. The surprise was that the hippocampus in the people that walked actually got larger. They actually reversed the atrophy. The hippocampus actually looked like somebody 20 years younger in the people that walked. That's a powerful effect. This is not an association study. This is a prospective randomized trial where ahead of time they said, this group, you do what you normally do. This group, you're going to start a walking program. So this is more reliable in terms about thinking about cause and effect type of relationships. When I first saw the study, I was just blown out of the water. Because, you know, we use drugs a lot in medicine, and we never know if they work, or they barely work, or they don't do anything, or they cause side effects. And I go to my clinic at Stanford, and I thought, wow, I'm giving our Alzheimer patients the same drugs I had 15 years ago, and I'm always embarrassed about that. And that's why we're working so hard to change that. What if I had a drug that I could walk into my clinic at Stanford and say, you know, we've got this new drug out. It's going to reverse the shrinkage of your hippocampus. I know that sounds like science fiction, but seriously, we've got this new drug that can reverse brain shrinkage. And that's powerful, and every powerful drug has side effects. So if you were my patient, you'd say, what are the side effects? Well, here are the side effects of this drug. Less hypertension, less diabetes, and less depression. So you'd say, well, yeah, write me a prescription. I'm ready. And then I tell you, okay, you need to do brisk walking or some form of exercise 30 minutes a day, 5 days a week. You'd be really disappointed, and you probably wouldn't take it. So that's where we are on the that brain exercise effect. Now, we say we're born with our genes and there's nothing we can do about it. I thought this was fascinating in terms of that statement and the power of exercise. So we're going back to the ApoE here. So that E4 version of ApoE is thought to help amyloid accumulate in the brain, right? That's why we don't want the E4 version. So in this study, they did the amyloid PET scans, and they measured amyloid accumulated in the brain in people aged 45 to 88. These are normal people with one parent with Alzheimer's, so they're at high risk. And they looked at whether or not they exercised during the past 10 years. And so in this graph here, on the left-hand side, we have the people that don't have the E4 high-risk gene. And they divided them up into non-exercisers and exercisers. The ones without the E4 high-risk genes both had fairly low levels of amyloid. However, if we shift over to the right, the people that were unlucky and got the E4 ApoE gene, the non-exercisers had the high amyloid accumulation, as we might expect. But look what happened in the exercisers. The people that the E4 bad gene that causes amyloid accumulation and increases dramatically the risk for Alzheimer's disease, the amyloid didn't accumulate in the exercisers. Now, this is a retrospective study, so again, not as reliable as a prospective study, but again, kind of shocks you in terms of the potential power of exercise. So people have analyzed all the papers with exercise and dementia risk, and I don't have time to summarize them in detail, but I would summarize the bottom line is that exercise probably reduces Alzheimer's risk by about 40%. You know, we saw Mediterranean diet maybe 20%, exercise 40%, cognitive exercise, we have no idea. And what do we mean by exercise? We don't know exactly how different exercises compare, but as a rule of thumb, I would recommend what the American Cancer Society or American Heart Association recommends. These studies, on average, we'd be talking about 5 days a week, 30 minutes a day of what we call moderate exertion. What are the rules of thumb for moderate exertion? One would start sweating slightly after 10 minutes on a normal temperature. One would not be comfortable speaking in complete sentences if you're walking with somebody, so it has to be a little bit brisk. Or one could take your pulse, and you want to be at 65 to 70% of your maximum predicted heart rate for your age. And there's a little formula that you could take your age and plug it in, and it tells you your maximum predicted heart rate. You want to be at about 65, 70% of that. But then you have to take your pulse, so a lot of people don't do that. So there are ways of judging moderate exercise. But these aren't running marathons or anything like that. This study looked at resistance training and mild cognitive impairment. They took women in their 70s with a diagnosis of MCI for 6 months. This is a prospective trial. They put one group only twice a week on resistance, so the harder training, And then the other half did balance and toning, a little easier. And the ones on the harder resistance training had improved cognitive function, executive function, that's the ability to multitask, and association memory after 6 weeks of just twice a week. So I recommend 5 days a week, but even 2 or 3 days a week probably has an effect. There have been several, at least a small number of prospective randomized clinical trials of exercise in Alzheimer's disease. Again, we don't have randomized clinical trials in brain exercises. We only have two little tiny ones in Mediterranean diet, 2 and 4 weeks, that are too short to mean much. But at least we have a few in exercise, and the overall analysis does show significant effect in terms of improving cognitive function in patients in earlier stages of Alzheimer's disease. They're small studies, but at least they show that. And let's wrap up on sleep. We have studies coming out. Christine Yaffe, one of my colleagues at UCSF, has done a lot of work in this area. And her group and other groups have shown that people that have a sleep-associated disruptive breathing have 1.5 to 2 times increased likelihood of coming down with MCI or Alzheimer's disease. So we worry about sleep. And this study just came out that I found fascinating. Like, why would sleep promote Alzheimer's disease? They measured amyloid levels in the spinal fluid of subjects. And these are people that don't have Alzheimer's yet. They're in very early stages or at risk. They put a catheter in instead of a spinal tap. And they had one group, that top line there, they're looking at amyloid levels over time, over a night and into the next morning. And the people with a normal sleep, where their sleep was not interrupted during that blue square there, in the morning their amyloid levels dropped. So during that last 2 hours of sleep, if the sleep wasn't interrupted, the amyloid levels dropped. The people that had their sleep interrupted 5 different times during the night, their amyloid levels did not drop. So it's fascinating that maybe what happens during sleep is some of that amyloid's being cleared out of the brain, and maybe that's why people that have disrupted sleep are at higher risk for Alzheimer's. Anyway, that's where the field is now. The sleep in Alzheimer's is confusing because it's a little bit of chicken and egg. We do know that people with Alzheimer's have sleep mechanisms that are disrupted, so it could be the Alzheimer's causing the problem with sleep. This study suggests it goes the other way too, that early on in our lives, if we have years and years of disrupted sleep, maybe we're at higher risk for amyloid accumulation and Alzheimer's. We find that people, with this one study, if you just focus on the bottom of the amyloid PET scans, people that on the average slept less than 6 hours were accumulating more amyloid in their brain than the people that slept more than 7 hours. Again, pointing to a sleep and amyloid interaction. So to summarize then, physical exercise, we have a lot of studies. We have some prospective randomized controlled trials. We've got about a 40% decrease in risk. Diet, if we can stick to a Mediterranean diet, maybe 20% decreased risk, but we don't have prospective trials for the most part. There's no nutraceutical that I think works, so that's easy to summarize. Now, I just summarized 1,000 websites right there. Sleep, interesting, you know, most of us try to get decent sleep for many reasons, heart, cancer, Alzheimer's. And then finally, cognitive exercise, it might be fun, there might be something there, we don't know yet. But life is not separate silos like this. We study things separately so we can figure out what's going on. My guess is that there are synergisms between these things. My guess is that if you exercised and had a Mediterranean diet, and exercised your brain, and got a good night's sleep, you'd have a very powerful effect. But in research, it's hard to study everything all at the same time. People are starting to study these things in combination, but we don't have as much data there. For FDA-approved therapies, we're on kind of steady here. We need new drugs. We've got the 3 cholinesterase inhibitors that most of you are familiar with. They'll have about the same of effect, boosting the neurotransmitters, but they're not slowing the degeneration or preventing it. We all our patients try these, but we're not slowing the degeneration or stopping it. We've got Namenda, similar effect. There's a so-called medical food called Axona. It's medium chain fats. There's only one publication on that. The data is completely unimpressive. I don't know how it got approved by the FDA as a medical food, but we generally aren't recommending that one. You heard in the news recently more trials in the pipeline using antibodies to clear amyloid. People are starting to use antibodies to clear abnormal forms of tau. This one was announced in Nice in March. I was at the meeting in Nice. It made a lot of news because it was probably the best effect yet on an amyloid antibody, clearing some amyloid out of the brain by PET imaging and slowing loss of cognitive function in mild Alzheimer's cases. It was just an early phase one trial, but we'll anxiously follow this for their phase two trial. But this is probably the most exciting antibody development right now. But again, before this could hit the market, we're talking 3 years or something like that. But this is the type of thing we need to see. Another exciting trial we started at Stanford, this was in the news, where my colleagues, Tony Weiss-Corey, my lab helped with this also. You can take old mice shown in gray and arrange it so their blood supply is shared with young mice shown in white. And then you can look at the brain of the old mice. And normally, the old mice, just like humans, they lose their synaptic spines and synaptic connections as they age. But those old mice that got infused with blood from young mice, the spines came back, the synaptic connections came back. So all kinds of comments on there about vampires and blood, et cetera. But this looked like a very powerful biologic effect. And the cognition of those old mice, one way the cognition is tested, the mice get a little, the buzzer goes off in their cage and they get an electric shock on the floor. And so next time that buzzer goes off, they freeze. Because they're remembering that buzzer is not going to bring a good thing. The young mice remember that much faster than the old mice. But when you give those old mice that young blood, they perform just as well as the young mice. So believe it or not, we've started a trial at Stanford where we're giving people with mild Alzheimer's disease plasma from young volunteers through the Stanford Blood Bank and, of course, all the appropriate approvals. We don't know if this will work yet, but it's exciting. And Tony Weiss-Corey's group is working on narrowing down what part of that young blood is causing this effect, with the idea we don't want to treat forever with blood, but if we could figure out the part in that young blood that's doing this, wow, wouldn't that be something? And then our own group is working on molecules to treat Alzheimer's, and we've managed to completely reverse the loss of spines that occur in Alzheimer's mice. And we've moved one of our, you get these shrunken dendrites and spines in that middle figure. And then when we give our drug, we reverse it, and the spines and neurites look just like we have in a normal young mouse. And Bill mentioned that we have one of our compounds, we're developing several compounds, has finished phase one trials in humans, and we look forward to getting that into Alzheimer patients during 2016. So to wrap up, if you're in the neighborhood, you'll see on Quarry Road next to the Stanford Mall a brand new building. This is where our neurology and neurosurgery departments are moving. It'll be mostly neurology. This will be the largest neurological outpatient center in the Western United States, be larger than anything in Los Angeles or the Bay Area. We have almost 100 neurologists now at Stanford. And we're still hiring more because just we can't keep up with demand. Our dementia and memory disorders program, of course, is a very high priority for us. And in this beautiful new clinic, we hope to do everything we can to be promoting brain health and preventing these using the various strategies that we discussed. And I can't wait. I'm going to keep going every week to my dementia clinic at Stanford. One of these days, I'm going to walk in there and be able to prescribe something that I don't have now. I don't care how long it takes, but I'm going to do that. And maybe the drug we're developing. So, anyway, so I'll wrap up. Thank you. So I think what's next is Bill and I will work on questions from the audience.
Why did you decide to go into this field?
Good question. Why did I decide to go into this field? Couple of reasons. I actually grew up with a younger sister who has cerebral palsy, that's brain damage at birth. And my mother is a nurse, and I got dragged along to countless doctor visits. And my question was, my sister is in a wheelchair. My basic question was, why didn't they make her walk? We came all the way to the doctors, and she went in a wheelchair, and I expect her to walk out. And my mother said, well, there's no treatments for brain damage. So I got this naive idea in my mind that I wanted to make a treatment for the brain. And then in medical school, my friends were going into orthopedics and things where you could fix something, you could cure people. So why do you want to do neurology? You can't cure anybody. And I thought, well, that's exactly why I want to do neurology. Because we need to cure, we need to be able to treat the brain. We can't just keep saying the brain's not treatable. It is treatable, we just have to figure out how to do it. And I think we're getting pretty close.
Yeah, wonderful. You know, Frank, you talked about that Medicare doesn't pay for the PET scan right now. And you probably are aware that Centers for Medicaid Services just came together. The Alzheimer's Association actually worked and provided some leadership on this with $100 million to study how PET scans might be useful. What do you hope comes out of that?
Yeah, I hope, yeah. So we, at Stanford, we'll be participating in that study. We'll make funding available for people to get this amyloid PET scan without having to pay the $3,000. I hope what comes out of that study is a paradigm shift where we can look in the brain and really know much more about what's going on in our, especially our patients with mild cognitive impairment or that are presenting in unusual ways and we're not sure if it's Alzheimer's or not, so our diagnosis will be more accurate. So I'm hoping what we get are improved diagnostic accuracy, a better platform to think about therapeutics and prevention, and just more insight.
What is BDNF?
Oh, I'm sorry, BDNF, brain-derived neurotrophic factor. It's a naturally occurring protein growth factor that is the most powerful substance known for maintaining that synaptic connection or dictating it to form in the first place. As we age, our BDNF, or brain-derived neurotrophic protein levels go down. And so it was hoped that that protein could be used as a treatment for brain disorders like Alzheimer's, where we're losing synaptic connections. But like most proteins, it's not very stable. If you swallowed it, it would be broken up in the stomach. If you injected it in the blood, it would dissolve. It wouldn't get through the blood-brain barrier. So what our group did was really the first in the world to figure out how to make a small drug-like molecule that does what BDNF does, and that's what's having that very powerful effect, and we hope to get that into Alzheimer's patients.
So here's a sort of broad question, I think, and a good one. So American Scientific in May 2015 states that over 400 trials, 99% have failed. So talk about this notion. There have been, in my own 28 years with the Alzheimer's Association, there have been lots of things that look promising to us in phase two. Our friends at Janssen in South San Francisco spent over $1 billion on bapineuzumab and ended up with nothing to go to market with. What's your sense of what that tells you as a scientist?
Yeah, why are these trials failing? I think there are probably four or five factors that go into that. I think, you know, these treatments, as we learn more and more about the actual mechanisms that cause a degeneration, I think our targeting will be more effective and we'll get larger effect sizes. I think for some of these things that have been tried, I'm glad they've been tried, but the effect size may have been too small to detect a beneficial effect. Another problem in these trials is that the patients that were recruited into the trials, much of this recruitment was done without the amyloid PET scans or some of our other more recent technology. And it turns out that 25 or 30% of the patients in these trials didn't even have Alzheimer's disease. They had some other cause of dementia, so you wouldn't expect an Alzheimer's treatment to work, so that makes it harder to detect an effect. I think other issues were that we didn't have as many ways to look at these patients. Fourth problem, that in their first generations of trials, patients with fairly advanced stages were in the trials, and those are probably the most difficult to treat, so the field now is moving towards treating earlier. I don't want to abandon the more advanced patients. In fact, the way our drug works, I think it'll work on more advanced patients as well. And finally, many of the treatments that were in these trials, when they were tried on Alzheimer's mice, they were tested in mice that made it a little too easy to have success in the mice, and then we got failures in the humans. So we're avoiding that by testing many different forms of mouse Alzheimer's and treating late stage mouse Alzheimer's so that tells us early on, if we want to fail early and it tells us that our drug's powerful. So that combination of factors, mm-hmm. I think we're doing better at now, and I think we'll start to get some successes.
Okay. Question about using the word dementia and referencing the DSM-5, it sounds like it's going to be dropped from the literature. What's your sense of that?
Yeah, I'm not. I'm a neurologist rather than a psychiatrist or psychologist, so I would defer to my colleagues there. I know the DSM's been redone, but I don't really know that issue of the term dementia is being dropped. In neurology, we certainly find it a very useful term. It captures 25 or 30 disorders, and it's a very real clinical entity. So I can't speak beyond that.
Gotcha. Several questions following up on the sleep relationship. So I'll throw three of them out, and you take them as you see fit or bundle them. A nurse case manager says she has seen patients being given gabapentin for sleep. Your opinion about this? Someone's heard that taking Ambien or Tylenol PM increases the risk for Alzheimer's disease. These are things that are over-the-counter things that are sometimes taken for sleep. And then a question about if you have to sleep with sleep aids, does that negate the benefit of the sleep you're getting?
Yeah, those are all really great questions. In terms of, gabapentin or any other medications for sleep, I think, the first choice, and I know this doesn't always work, are good sleep hygiene practices of people minimizing or not sleeping, preferably during the day, the routine for bedtime, et cetera. We have a very large sleep program at Stanford that's one of the best in the world. I'm not formally trained in sleep, but I interact with our sleep team all the time. And when we send patients from neurology to our sleep colleagues, that's always their starting point, all the sleep hygiene, because you don't want somebody taking naps during the day when they shouldn't be and then drugging them at night so they can go to bed. So I'd start with sleep hygiene. In terms of the various medications that are used, they have a whole sequence they go through of short-acting to longer-acting drugs. Gabapentin, I don't know much about. With dementias, including Alzheimer's, we worry about any kind of sedative because when people have a compromised cognitive function in the brain, any drug that's a sedative or any drug that has a brain side effect, those effects will be magnified in a compromised brain. So that's why a drug like Ambien, I don't think makes the neurodegeneration process worse or faster, but for what cognition they have left, that cognition is more vulnerable to any drug like Ambien. So we really try to avoid those kinds of drugs.
Thank you. A couple more questions around diet. One, have you seen in the many, many websites you've reviewed, have you seen anything about the gluten-free diet, big issue today? And a ketogenic diet. I'll be honest, I don't know what a ketogenic diet is, but...
Right. Yeah, for the gluten, first of all, I haven't seen... So gluten sensitivity has been considered in terms of whether or not it's a causal factor in many neurologic disorders, including forms of dementia, ataxia, almost everything. And it's been very difficult to find a causal role for gluten sensitivity other than in rare forms of what we call ataxia, where the cerebellum, the part of the brain that controls coordination, seems to be a little bit vulnerable in a very small number of patients with gluten disorders. I'm not aware of, you know, really reliable research for dementia. So I don't know if gluten sensitivity contributes to dementia risk. A lot of unknowns, but there's just not great evidence out there for it, so I'm not too worried about it. What was the second part?
The ketogenic.
Ketogenic
diet.
Yeah, that's a diet which I've never tried. It's our epileptologists use that diet. Apparently, it's pretty hard to get people to stick to, where, as the name implies, people eat a lot of foods that generate ketones in the body. So they do lower carbohydrates and higher what we call medium chain triglycerides. The coconut oil has medium chain triglycerides. And the theory there is to give the neurons an alternative source of energy. So in Alzheimer's disease, it's been found that neurons can have some trouble using glucose, just like people with diabetes. And so that's why there's actually a trial right now giving intranasal insulin to people with Alzheimer's, with the idea of, let's help the neurons use glucose better. An alternative energy source for all cells, including neurons, are medium-chain triglycerides, or so-called ketones. So that's the theory. I mentioned that one trial currently going on in South Florida where they're giving medium-chain triglycerides. That would be another approach for a ketogenic diet, to see if there will be an effect, and we just don't have that data yet. My colleagues in epilepsy say these ketogenic diets, to really do it properly, are not easy to do. So in the absence of any data, and given the challenge, I don't know how practical that is.
Yeah. Frank, you talked about moving from MCI, mild cognitive impairment, to Alzheimer's, and I believe, I don't remember what age you referenced, but that the conversion rate over 5 years was about 30%?
Right, 35% or so, yes.
Yeah, and this question basically is, so what about 10 years and 15 years?
Yeah, so we mentioned that if one gets a diagnosis of MCI, the various studies, there's a range and anything else, but around 35% or so will convert to Alzheimer's over a subsequent 5 years. If one looked at 10 years, people don't study it generally for that long. My guess is we're getting up to 60, 70%. It's not 100% because there are people, maybe up to a third or so, that get diagnosed with MCI and the cause is not Alzheimer's there. It's not early stage Alzheimer's. It can be, for example, what we call vascular dementia, where the small blood vessels in the brain are affected by atherosclerosis and other things, and that the problem with the blood supply to the brain is causing the mild cognitive impairment. Those people are often quite stable. They're the ones that will stay MCI the rest of their lives and never convert to a dementia. So it does level off probably at around 60% or so.
So the Alzheimer's Association annually publishes a facts and figures document. And this year's special report came out of Medicare Services and reported that only 45% of people for whom the physician billed Medicare for Alzheimer's issues shared that diagnosis with patients and families. Mm-hmm. In other words, over half of the people with this disease whose doctor believes they have it share the diagnosis. Why do you think this is so?
Yeah, that's a great question. Why don't physicians share the diagnosis more often when in their physician's mind they're thinking, wow, this is probably Alzheimer's disease? We thought about that a lot. I think here are some of the factors. To give somebody that news of such a difficult diagnosis is hard on the physician emotionally. It takes a lot of time to be done properly. We're scheduled to see somebody in a follow-up for 20 minutes, 25 minutes. And by the time the patient's roomed, their vital signs are taken, we may have 10 or 5 minutes left to have a discussion. And so it's hard on physicians to have these discussions in a practical sense. and it's emotionally difficult. As physicians, we want to help people, and it's hard to tell somebody, you've got this disease that you'll die from and we have no effective therapies for. That is not an easy discussion to have when you've spent your entire life, whether you're a nurse or a psychologist or any kind of provider, to have, right? We're basically discussing our failure, that we can't, you know, we can't help you in terms of a cure. My own personal approach is, this is, I always try to put myself in the family and patient's position. I guess my mother taught me this as a nurse. I always ask her what her lifetime as a nurse was like, and she said that was, in nursing school, they always learn, put yourself in the patient's position. And I'm in my late 50s, and I have some cognitively challenging days. And so I thought, wow, these little glimpses, this must be what it's like when it first starts, right? Kind of scary. And I think, wow, if I were in the early stages of this, but I still could think about things, could still think about what to do with the rest of my life, my family, and my kids, but I didn't know anything about Alzheimer's. And if someone didn't share that with me, I would be really unhappy. I'd be really unhappy. So I err on the side of full disclosure. If I'm worried that my patient might have Alzheimer's, I'm going to share my thoughts. I don't want to alarm people unnecessarily, but I think, you know, I've spent a lot of years trying to get good at this, but, you know, if it's not your field, it's harder to do. And I think a lot of those statistics come from my colleagues in primary care. They aren't neurologists, they aren't geriatric psychiatrists, they aren't trained in this, and so I have some empathy for them, and that's what creates the problem.
Yeah, thank you. It's interesting to note to me that in that same report in 1961, there was a study that 90% of the time doctors did not share cancer diagnosis with patients. 90% of the time in 1961. Now, I'm old enough to think 1961 was just the other day, so it seems like we've made a lot of progress.
I think it's moving forward, and what will really accelerate this are the therapeutics.
Sure.
If I'm looking at somebody in early stages of mild cognitive impairment, and I know this data on exercise, and they're not exercising, what a disaster if I didn't tell them about, hey, this is what you have, here's what you can do.
Yeah. So somebody asked me a question, does the Alzheimer's Association only fund research in Northern California? And the answer is absolutely not. We funded Dr. Longo when he was in North Carolina. We, as I said before, largest private nonprofit funders of Alzheimer's science in the world, and we fund literally internationally. We put the money on the table twice a year. People like Dr. Longo and his colleagues, Dr. Grecius, we've funded, others at Stanford, others at UCSF, at Davis, at the Gladstone Institute, the Buck Center. Our chapter here in Northern California raised $6.7 million for our national grants program last year, but I don't have anything to say about who gets the money. If it went to the most charming luncheon speaker, Frank would do very well. Frank does very well, but we let the scientists decide. Every proposal that comes to us is farmed out for peer review, and other researchers review the proposals and tell us what the chances of success and how impactful they think it will be. We can set guidelines for what we're looking for from year to year, but they are peer reviewed. It's very competitive. We're able to fund about the top 8-9% of proposals that come to us. So a lot of excellent science doesn't get funded every year. But the fact that these folks get grants means that they're pretty meritorious. Frank, dig into this as much or as little as you want to. So this question is about, can you comment on the report out of UCLA piloting a multi-pronged, individualized approach to cognitive function? You know about this?
Dale Bredesen.
Yeah, exactly. That's what I think.
Yeah, so that report, Dale Bredesen, who was at the Buck and now is at UCLA, and he's still interacting with the Buck, he published a paper a few months ago that was in the news. So what Dale's been experimenting with is just in terms of optimizing as many factors as he could for people in generally early stages of cognitive impairment, exercise, sleep, diet, all, you know, the things we talked about here. And he reported on a collection of 10 or 15 patients or so who found that when they did all these things together, they felt their cognition was better. So this is what we call an open label exploratory approach. And so that's why it was exciting. But it's, you know, it's just an exploration. Open label means people aren't blinded. There's not a placebo. And cognitive testing, any kind of neurologic testing, is very susceptible to bias. And so that kind of study just points to a direction for future work. It doesn't allow us to make any conclusions, although I would come to the same conclusion we already discussed. I would try to do as many of these things as I could in terms of physical exercise and things. That's what Dale has published, and people, you know, we're excited about it.
Yeah, and someone asked about this, and I remember when the Nunn study was being written about quite a bit several years ago out of the U of Kentucky. Socialization, is that part of the picture as well?
Yeah, I think socialization is, again, part of using our cognition. You know, those synaptic connections I showed are very much a use it or lose it system. I didn't show a video that I have, but I showed those spines, right, that reach out and form that connection. I have a video of those where those spines are moving around. They reach out, they look for a connection, and if they don't find one, they go back in like that. So every hour to hour, our spines are attempting to form connections, and they go back in. Once they find a partner and form a connection, it's what we call just a new, delicate connection. If it's used, if we start getting electrical signals across that connection is solidified. And then that synaptic connection is a new one, and it lasts. If it's not used, that spine just goes right back in. So it's a very much use or lose it. So I think socialization is just a great way to use a lot of brain circuits and enhance and maintain those connections. I think that's why the socialization is so powerful. I think a computer game might just tap a very small part of that.
Mm-hmm. Question about end-stage Alzheimer's disease and the impact of losing the swallowing reflex. And is there any research about what that subjective experience is like for people to withdraw feeding at the end?
Yeah, what's it like to withdraw feeding? There is research. I mean, there's a whole field of palliative care. We have physician and nurse colleagues who train specifically in end-stage care. They research it. Of course, no one can get into a person's mind that's at end stages and then dies, so we don't have the kind of information we'd really like to have. But they do everything they can to try to gauge a person's comfort and stress level from their professional perspectives, and that's their whole passion of their profession, is people's quality of life at end stages. And I think I'm not trained in that area. I look to them for guidance with my patients that are really advanced. We know a little bit about it's like to lose swallowing mechanism from our stroke patients that can lose that temporarily, and it's very stressful, that feeling of not being able to control what's going on with swallowing. That's why we can't feed those patients. That's why we either put a tube down the throat or, you know, a PEG tube into the stomach. So to avoid that stress.
Yeah, we have time for about two, three short questions. You commented, and I think we all understand the lack of effective treatment options we have. Do you still prescribe Dementia, the Aricept, the cholinesterase inhibitors?
Yes. So I and our group still prescribes those. Don't get me wrong. We offer them to all our patients, and we monitor for side effects. They boost the neurotransmitter function at that synapse a little bit. So they, in many patients, their cognitive function, memory, and other cognitive functions can get a little better for a year, or sometimes the effect lasts longer than a year, and any little bit helps, and if you get that little bit of help without side effects, that's great. There are a few studies showing the combination of one of the cholinesterase inhibitors like Aricept plus the Dementia can be a little more effective together, although not every study shows that. Some do. So we'll start one of them first, one of the cholinesterase inhibitors, and then if there are no side effects and everything looks okay and they're up to a regular dose, then we'll add on the memantine or the Namenda. I don't like starting two drugs at the same time, because if there's a side effect, I don't know which one's causing the side effect. So we do offer those to everybody. Mm-hmm. A question that comes up, people with mild cognitive impairment, the MCI, they often get started on those drugs. And I keep monitoring the research there. But the research shows that they aren't of benefit in MCI, that the side effects often outweigh any little benefit there might be. So we tend to wait till the patients are beyond MCI before we start those drugs. There are exceptions, of course, but mm-hmm. that question comes
there,
up.
There are two or three questions wanting to dig into Dr. Weiss-Corey's old blood, new blood.
Right.
So any sense of what that mechanism might be?
Yeah, what's the mechanism of the young blood? He thinks part of it might be the immune system. So as we get older, and in these neurodegenerative diseases like Alzheimer's, our immune system gets a little over-responsive. And we live in a mild inflammatory state as we age. We get out of bed in the morning, our joints are a little sore, our muscles are a little sore. That's just this low-grade inflammation that just accumulates with age. That inflammation is very hard on the brain, and in fact, inflammatory mechanisms contribute to Alzheimer's as well. I talked about tau and amyloid. There's also inflammation going on up there. So one effect might be to quiet down this inflammation by the young blood, because the older blood has these what we call cytokines, or part of the immune system inflammation. Another part, and I don't want to keep coming back to physical exercise, but there's one protein called eotaxin that its levels change as we age, and exercise affects that level. So being young or exercising optimizes its level, and he thinks he's optimizing the level of that with the young blood going into the old mice.
I promise to be on the treadmill before the end of the day.
Okay, but don't hurt yourself. We always say do no harm, but I don't want is anybody to go out and start walking and break a hip. You have to be appropriately cautious.
And someone actually asked this question. I think I know the answer, but swimming would be just as good, right?
Yeah, I think swimming would be just as good. I mean, my family's asked me that all the time, comparing the different exercises. It's probably just getting the heart rate up and the exercise effect. I doubt that it matters whether it's walking, swimming. If you can't move your legs, doing one of these things, just getting the heart rate up and getting a little sweat going.
Doesn't have to be load-bearing.
Yeah.
Final question. Frank, the National Alzheimer's Plan calls for disease-modifying treatments by 2025. That's what we want the federal government to take seriously. We want them to fund at appropriate levels. What's your sense? We knew, I think, we were part of establishing that goal, that it was an ambitious goal. I think mm-hmm. you probably agree with that. What do you think our chances are?
I think they're fairly good. So we're talking disease-modifying, not a cure.
Which we don't have today.
Not a cure, necessarily, in 10 years.
Right. And I
think there will be incremental effects. My guess is one of these antibody trials that are currently ongoing, either antibody against amyloid or tau, will come out with a big phase 3 trial, maybe in the next 3, 4, 5 years, that will show a little bit of slowing of the decline of cognition. So that'll meet the goal of disease modifying. It's not where we want to be. We want to prevent it altogether, but at least stop the decline in cognition. But a slowing will be a first step, and that'll be exciting. I think by 10 years, we'll be trying combinations of treatment. So I think the drug we're developing, for example, plus maybe an antibody approach, we'll start to see bigger effects with combinations. And I think the HIV treatment analogy is a fair one. Many times analogies are exaggerated. But remember, with HIV, we have 3 different drugs people can be on. Each drug alone just gives a tiny effect or it's not effective. But all 3 together have been highly effective. One mm-hmm. could live a full lifespan now with HIV. We'll see that with Alzheimer's. People will be on 2 or 3 different drugs having big effects. One thing for sure that whenever we predict, we don't know what we're talking about, but I think in 10 years we will have some disease, one or more disease modifying effects.
Wonderful. Dr. Frank Longo, thank you very much.
Thank you.